Good evening, everybody. This is Brother Lloyd. Shabbat Shalom to all the Sabbath keepers out there. I hope you're all prepared for a wonderful and blessed Sabbath day. This lesson is titled, The Peace and Quiet of Home. Now, the word of the Most High says in Romans 12:18 that, if it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men, and also follow peace with all men and holiness, without the which no man shall see the Lord. That's Hebrews 12:14. So in a general sense, peace is meant to be a state or condition of quietness or tranquility. It is a freedom from the disturbance or agitation as we apply it to society or to individuals, or even to the temperament of our own mind. Peace also means to be free from war and strife with others and self, that freedom from internal commotion or civil war that we can have with ourselves. It means to be free from the agitation or disturbance by the passions such as fear, terror, anxiety, anger, desires, and so forth. Quietness of mind, tranquility, calmness, and the quietness of conscience is what we're seeking, people. This is peace. Great peace have they which love the law, and nothing shall offend them. Psalms 119, 165. Now, that's interesting because the word tells us that to be offended, in essence, comes from a lack of peace within us. So keep this in mind, people, when you take offense to things, something that someone says or do, it shows that there is a lack of peacefulness in you that only the Most High can provide you with. So there is still a work to do based on your level of sensitiveness when it comes to being offended by words said and things done. This is a self-evaluation moment about where we are in trusting the Lord. Do you have His peace or your own temperamental peace which shifts as the wind blows in whatever direction? Isaiah 26:3 says, Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee because he trusteth in thee. This is a decree from the Most High. And when we stay focused on Him, He will fulfill His promise, people. His word is true. His word is sure. Isaiah 32:17 says, And the work of righteousness shall be peace, and the effect of righteousness, quietness, and assurance forever. This is what obedience for the love of His law brings. Heavenly rest, or the happiness of heaven. Harmony and agreement between parties, a state of reconciliation between parties that are at variance. So let's focus on peace in the home. When you're out and about or at work, do you look forward to getting home to some peace and quiet after a long day? Or do you pull up in your driveway, sitting in the car, dreading going inside because there's more variance inside your home than out in the world? Order is necessary for a happy and peaceful home. Order is necessary for a happy and peaceful home. But if your home isn't led by the direction of the Most High and His Holy Spirit, peace will be a difficult thing to come by because the adversary will always keep anarchy running amok because of the lack of authority of the Most High in your home. Ellen White wrote this, and she says, God is displeased with disorder, slackness, and a lack of thoroughness in anyone. These deficiencies are serious evils and tend to wean the affections of the husband from the wife when the husband loves order, well-disciplined children, and a well-regulated house. A wife and mother cannot make home agreeable and happy unless she possesses a love for order, preserves her dignity, and has good government. Therefore, all who fail on these points shall begin at once to educate themselves in this direction and cultivate the very things wherein is their greatest lack. That's from A Venice Home, chapter 22. She also says this, Mother, this is your sacred work. My sister, Christ has committed to you the sacred work of teaching His commandments to your children. In order to be fitted for this work, you must yourself live in obedience to all His precepts. Cultivate a watchful observance of every word and action. Guard most diligently your words. Overcome all hastiness of temper. For impatience, if manifested, will help the adversary to make the home life disagreeable and unpleasant for your children. That's Great Controversy, page 68. Here is why parents fail. Some parents, although they profess to be religious, profess to be believers, profess to know the Most High, profess to worship, profess to know and keep His commandments, they, according to Sister White, do not keep before their children the fact that God is to be served and obeyed, that convenience, pleasure, or inclination should not interfere with His claims upon them. So when you're only professing with your mouth, but you're doing something different, this is what you're teaching your children. They are learning that the word of the Most High is not important because they can still do whatever they want and they see no consequences for not listening and obeying the word. Are you setting your household and your children up for damnation? You need to ask yourself that question. Psalm 111:10 reads, The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all they that do His commandments. His praise endureth forever. We can only have wisdom and teach it to our children by fearing and reverencing the Most High and His word. We only receive understanding by being obedient to the word. This also means studying the word, people. 2 Timothy 2:15. Now, Sister White continues and says this. The fact should be woven into the very life and character, the right conception of God through the knowledge of Christ who died that we might be saved should be impressed upon their minds. Adventist Home, page 323. You may think, parents, that you have not time to do all this, but you must take time to do your work in your family. Else, Satan will supply the deficiency. Cut out everything else from your life that prevents this work from being done and train your children after His order. Neglect anything of a temporal nature. Be satisfied to live economically. Bind about your wants. But for Christ's sake, do not neglect the religious training of yourselves and your children. Adventist Home, page 324. So, back out to the driveway and you sitting in your car. As you hesitate in dread, trying to delay the inevitable chaos and mayhem of the home which you are to be the head of if you're the husband, or in control and order of if you're the wife sitting in the car, consider these words. Matthew 10:32-37 reads, Whosoever therefore shall confess before men, him will I confess also before my Father which is in heaven. So, have you and your spouse openly confessed before man and your children, acknowledging that his will be done in your lives and your household? Or have you both denied him as a ruler and leader of your lives and home because of your love for the world and the things it offers? Mark 8:38 reads, "For whosoever shall be ashamed of me and of my words among this adulterous and sinful generation, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed also, when he cometh in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." So, if you haven't given charge of your life and your home to the Most High, who do you think is running your home? Verse 33. "But whosoever shall deny me before men, him will I also deny before my Father which is in heaven. Think not that I am come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword." Understand this, people. Wherever the word of the Most High is preached, dissension will always follow. The word is for each individual to accept or deny as it has always been. He says in verse 35, "For I am come to set a man at variance against his father, and the daughter against her mother, and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and a man's foes shall be they of his own household." If your household is not following the order and law of the Most High, that truth will set everyone in it against each other. Micah 7:6 says, "For the son dishonoreth the father, the daughter rises up against her mother, the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. A man's enemies are the men of his own house." So in simple speak, everyone will be against each other. And for those of you who have stepmothers or fathers in a household, if the Most High is not running your household, you're living this chaos. This is all a result of not having the peace of the Most High in your lives and in your home. The husband and wife always at odds with one another. The children are at odds with one another. Children are at odds with the father and at odds with the mother also, because Satan is running the household and not the Holy Spirit, because he's been denied by the disobedient parents. Verse 37, "He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me." Sister White says this, "It is a hard matter to adjust family difficulties, even when husband and wife seek to make a fair and just settlement in regard to their several duties, if they have failed to submit the heart to God. How can a husband and wife divide the interests of their home life and still keep a loving, firm hold upon each other? They should have a united interest in all that concerns their homemaking, and the wife, if a Christian or if a believer, will have her interest with her husband as his companion, for the husband is to stand as the head of the household. The husband is to stand as the head of the household. Christ in each heart will bring unity. If the will of God is fulfilled, the husband and wife will respect each other and cultivate love and confidence. Anything that would mar the peace and unity of the family should be firmly repressed, and kindness and love should be cherished. He who manifests the spirit of tenderness, forbearance, and love will find that the same spirit will be reflected upon him. Where the Spirit of God reigns, there will be no talk of unsuitability in the marriage relation. If Christ indeed is formed within the hope of glory, there will be union and love in the home. Christ abiding in the heart of the wife will be at agreement with Christ abiding in the heart of the husband. They will be striving together for the mansions Christ has gone to prepare for those who love him. Adventist Home, page 120. A father must not be as a child, moved merely by impulse. He is bound to his family by sacred holy ties. Adventist Home, page 213. What his influence will be in the home will be determined by his knowledge of the only true God and Jesus Christ whom he sent. 1 Corinthians 13:11 reads, "When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things." Paul compares this life to our infancy or childhood, when we staggered and stammered rather than spoke clearly, and only thought and understood childish things, and therefore were in need of such things to form and frame our tongue and mind. But when we become men, to what purpose should we desire the stammering, the childish toys, and all those similar things, whereby our childhood is framed by little and little? Paul says, "But when I became a man, I put away childish things." Sister White says, "The father is to stand at the head of his family, not as an overgrown, undisciplined boy, but as a man with manly character and with his passions controlled. He is to obtain an education in correct morals. His conduct in his home life is to be directed and restrained by the pure principles of the Word of God. Then he will grow up to his full stature of a man in Christ Jesus." Adventist Home, page 213. We must have the Spirit of God, or we can never have harmony in the home. The wife, if she has the Spirit of Christ, will be careful of her words. She will control her spirit. She will be submissive, and yet she will be submissive and yet will not feel that she is a bond slave, but a companion to her husband. Let me read that again. She will be submissive and yet will not feel that she is a bond slave, but a companion to her husband. If the husband is a servant of God, he will not lord it over his wife. He will be arbitrary and exacting. We cannot cherish home affection with too much care. For the home, if the Spirit of the Lord dwells there, is a type of heaven. If one errs, the other will exercise Christ-like forbearance and not draw coldly away. Adventist Home, page 118. Neither the husband nor the wife should attempt to exercise over the other an arbitrary control. Do not try to compel each other to yield to your wishes. You cannot do this and retain each other's love. Be kind, patient, and forbearing, considerate, and courteous. By the grace of God, you can succeed in making each other happy, as in your marriage vow you promised to do. Adventist Home, page 118. And never forget that your children are learning first and foremost from what you do. And if they see that what you do doesn't match with what you say, they would choose which best suits them and their own desires. So, mothers and fathers, time to get out of your car as you sit in the driveway dreading to go into the home that you have created. Go in, draw your family together for a meeting, and tell them this. Joshua 24:15. "And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom ye will serve, whether the gods which your father served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." In other words, tell them that from this day forward, all will serve the Most High that live in your home according to His word and His will. You will no longer serve the world and the lust of it. Now, you must lead by example, and your actions must sync with your words, or Satan will come in and continue to have charge over your home, and there will be no peace. This is for the husband and wife. You both have to be on the same page. Psalms 34:14 reads, "Depart from evil and do good. Seek peace. Seek peace and pursue it." See, it's not going to just come. You have to be seeking it. Now understand that in pursuing and seeking peace for yourself and your household, you must fully surrender yourself to the Most High and flee also youthful lust, but follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. But foolish and unlearned questions avoid, knowing that they do gender strifes. And the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient, in meekness instructing those that oppose themselves, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the knowledge of the truth, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him and his will. That's 2 Timothy 2:22 through 26. The husband and wife must be on board on the same ark, so to speak, and not at strife with one another, and not having dysfunction with one another, or these things will continue. But if one is willing and the other is not, the one striving must continue to do so and trust that the Most High's will bless you in your efforts and continue to be that example. You have to continue to be that example, because we never know, for that unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband. 1 Corinthians 7:14. So move forward, get right with the Most High, surrender to Him, and bring that into your home and teach that to your children. Live it, eat it, breathe it, drink it. And remember, the Heavenly Father doesn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.